Since the Bundy Ranch story broke last week and culminated in a tense standoff with federal agents on Saturday, resulting in the release of the Bundy Ranch cattle, we've been following the money. On the 10th, we reported the militia arrived in the area and cited a former BLM volunteer and a Nevada land broker who revealed to us the true value of the land and the parties who are interested in it. Now, welcome to the program, Rusty.
Hello, Gary. Thanks for having me.
So, Rusty, before we get into the deep research that we've revealed here, how did you become an expert in this field?
Well, I grew up in eastern Kansas, and as the Kansas City suburbs grew out to our cattle ranch, my father started subdividing the land and getting involved in this type of business. And I learned a lot as a kid growing up. And he used to always quote Roy Rogers, the guy that went out north of L.A. and started paying top dollar for worthless land, that you got to figure out where the people want to go and get there first. So I grew up in that kind of environment. Eventually, when I was in my mid-30s, I was just sort of traveling around trying to figure out, you know, where the next land boom would be. And I was hanging out in Florida, hanging around real estate bigwigs, and started learning that the Las Vegas Valley was a really good bet because the casinos were growing in the late 80s and providing a lot of jobs. And there was a lot, at least 80,000 acres of really cheap available land in the Las Vegas Valley. So I did research and discovered that most of that land was originally given to Howard Hughes.
Now, you actually worked for the Howard Hughes Corporation, and you assisted them. Could you help us? Tell us about that.
Well, sort of what happened was is the Howard Hughes heirs, they had a company called Summa Corporation in the early to mid-90s, and they were having trouble finding certain parcels of the land that they inherited. And because of the knowledge that I gained as a volunteer for the BLM and other research that I did and do at the county, Clark County Recorder's office, they hired me to help them find certain parcels that they were looking for that they couldn't find. And so that was one of the initial things that got me involved in land use issues and what's going on with land. It started out specifically in the Las Vegas Valley. I helped them identify where 20,000 acres was and was able to get the records from the Clark County Recorder's office and help them organize their situation so that they could sell the land. They weren't able to sell the land because they didn't have the proper records and everything in hand. And I became an expert at being able to figure out, you know, what's what and all that sort of thing.
So when the Bundy Ranch situation flared up, what was your first inclination? What was your instinct to begin research?
Well, I knew right away that the general media was lying. They weren't explaining the right issue. They were talking about turtles at first. Well, I worked as a volunteer in Red Rock, in the Red Rock National Conservation Area, for over 10 years on the turtle situation, and there isn't any issue with protecting the desert tortoise out in that area where the Bundy Ranch is. It doesn't have anything to do with that. And the first clue to that came to me in the early 90s after they completed the I-15. They put this huge multi-million-dollar intersection in the middle of nowhere west of Bunkerville. And that was the first clue that there's some kind of big plan going on out there with that real estate out there. You don't put a huge highway interchange in the middle of nowhere.
So basically, by putting the interstate intersection, they're planning to build something. And now with the Bundy Ranch situation flaring up, the BLM comes in. They're trying to force him off of his land. And in the research that you've uncovered, the magnesium dolomite is a rich mineral in the ground, and it has military applications.
Yeah, well, what happened was is in the early 90s, the federal government, Congress, ordered that all of the real estate surrounding the Las Vegas area, all of the government land be surveyed. And because of my volunteer work for the BLM for many years, cleaning up trash all over the place, and I'm an avid four-wheel driver and hiker, I've been on every byway, back road, trail that you can imagine within a 50 to 100 mile radius of Las Vegas. And right away, whenever surveyors were coming out from the Geological Survey to do the congressional mandated survey, quite often they requested that I would escort them out there because I know how to get in and out of these areas. A lot of these areas are really dangerous and really, and you have to have experience to get in and out, and you have to know what you're doing. And I actually escorted surveyors out to this Bundy Ranch area, and that's how I first became familiar with it. And I was really surprised when we were exiting that exit there my first time. I was going, what's this huge interchange doing here in the middle of nowhere? And then we go down and we go up, and they wanted to go up and survey up to the Utah border up in this real rugged mountain area. And I was like, well, what's up with this? And a lot of these surveyors before that, there was a lot of areas that we surveyed where there's a lot of old abandoned mines. And actually, it's a real dangerous situation in southern Nevada. There's a huge amount of old abandoned mines. Almost all of them were magnesium mines. A lot of the bedrock all around this area is magnesium dolomite. And wherever any of this dolomite exists near an ancient undersea volcanic vent, there's real high-quality magnesium rocks. The reason why I know this is because when I first started coming across these rocks, they look like meteorites. And I thought it'd be the first time I found one, I go, this looks like a meteorite. So I rushed back to Las Vegas with it, and the geologist told me, no, it's not a meteorite. This is magnesium. And he explained the whole geological situation about it. And he explained to me that there's like a plant in the Las Vegas Valley that blew up years ago, where they used to pay people to go out and mine this magnesium, and they would sell it like on the open market, and they would get a lot of money for it, and they use it to make rocket fuel. And it was a real big business during World War II, and it continued after World War II for a significant time period. And then that whole thing kind of died down to a certain extent because a lot of people were freaking out because there's all these holes that are really deep all over southern Nevada. That in these miners, they went in and they dug out these holes, and then they left and they didn't fix anything. So it's really dangerous. And some of the volunteer work that I used to do for the BLM is to go out and put fences and warning signs around these holes. You could be hiking around, and your kid could be running around and fall into one of these old mine shafts, and they're done. And in fact, it's happened quite often. Kids and stuff would get trapped in these mine shafts, killed.
Let's talk about the Harry Reid connection, because the investigation that you uncovered at the Clark County Assessor's Office revealed that they actually have corporations that are bordering the Bundy property. Could you explain in detail?
Well, the way it works is like the Roy Rogers things that my father used to quote is, you got to figure out where the people are going to be and get there first. One of the best examples of that is McDonald's. What McDonald's does, McDonald's is not a hamburger company. They're one of the largest real estate companies in the world. The hamburger situation is just there so that they can cash in on the real estate. So what people do is they try to figure out what's going to happen with the rules and regulations with any particular area, and try to go in early and buy land when it's cheap, and then hold on to it, because land, you don't have to pay a whole lot of tax on it. And certain things, and then what happens is, as the development starts, then you can make deals and lease deals, and the value of the land goes up. Basically, what happens is every time a piece of land is subdivided, technically all the related land goes up in value, because they don't subdivide any land unless there's some kind of developments in the future expected to happen there.
So do you believe that Harry Reid and the corporations surrounding him have plans on that property itself?
Do they
have advanced knowledge of developments that'll take place there, hence the highway?
okay, well, this is what the situation is. The first clue to what's going on is a highway. And so whenever a highway goes in somewhere, there are these real estate people that are called vultures. And what vultures do is they look for first when the roads are going to get in. And they try to anticipate before the road goes in and start buying up land. Well, adjacent to where the road is, sometimes it can be kind of risky because sometimes plans change and different things go on. And usually the people that are most successful in being a vulture are ones that are connected to the government that's involved in planning where the road goes. And so what happens is, as a vulture real estate developer, what you're looking for is you're looking for land that you know is that a highway is going to be put in nearby, and you want to have some kind of future knowledge about what sort of development is going to go on so that you can place your land purchases strategically in a way where there'll be high quality roads, commercial area nearby, access to whatever's going on. And this kind of planning usually starts 20 to 30 years in advance. And a lot, I personally believe that there's people that high up in the federal government that take advantage of these situations.
Well, let's talk about some of the irregularities and anomalies that you discovered in the public record. What did you find?
Okay, well, basically, whenever I was researching land, before technology was available, I would go down to the county assessor's office and go through all the recorded land histories of each parcel. Well, now Clark County is real high tech now, and you can do a lot of that research right online. It's really easy. And so they have a system that used to be called the Info Mapper. I think it has a new name now. I forgot exactly what it is. But you can load up, you can go onto that page, and you can click around on the page, and everywhere you click, it pops up the history of the land of that particular parcel. It tells you the size of it, the ownership history, and what's been going on. And so what I did was, when this Bundy thing started getting into the news a couple of weeks ago, is I went on to the Clark County Assessor's website, and I started clicking around, checking out the land history of the lands there. And in the normally strategic areas where someone would want to acquire land for and be able to cash in later on down the road in the future by owning this land, I started checking out the history. And there's most of the original landowners in the Bunkerville area are Mormon elders. And I actually worked for a Mormon elder for a few years in Las Vegas, helping him with some of this research because they were worried about some of their people doing crooked land deals. And so I educated him on how to find out what's going on with these lands. And they were actually concerned about the Bunkerville area back in the mid-90s. So anyway, what I did was is I started clicking around. I noticed really strange things going on that are not normal in these types of situations related to the BLM. Basically, in general, the original mandate was that the BLM is managing sections, 640-acre parcels. They're sections. And the only time they're managing a land smaller than a section is if they have a section that borders private land. I started noticing around 1996 and on, they started acquiring intermingling properties, smaller and smaller sections, and going in and somehow acquiring what used to be private land, and then the recorded history was disappearing on some of these recorded parcels. And I started blowing the whistle on that around 1996 and 1997, and I couldn't get any clear answers from anybody. Like in the county recorder's office, I was like, and they would like say, oh, well, it's the federal government. They do what they're going to do.
Let me ask you that. So how did people respond to your whistleblowing on this?
Nobody really cared. And the important people that I associates in the real estate business, they said, well, then let's figure out what's going on and get in there and make some money. And
some of these properties had no cost at all. They were given to these corporations.
Basically, on that State Highway 170 that goes from that intersection in the middle of nowhere on the I-15 into Bunkerville, I started looking. Usually, those are the kind of places where this kind of stuff goes on. So I started clicking around in the area associated with that road that goes into Bunkerville there, just northeast of the Bunkerville property. And I noticed that a lot of the suspicious land activity started in the mid-80s. And and there's some of the parcels that I clicked on had histories that were reminiscent from my past experience of somebody having some kind of land battle. Sometimes what will happen is a bank will, like you'll get a loan from a bank, and then you'll go into financial trouble, and the bank will try to take your land. And then usually what happens is somehow a big company ends up with it. It's really strange how this is strange. This kind of thing doesn't happen in Kansas, but I started noticing it happens a lot in Southern Nevada. And you can't get, and it's really hard to, when you go, like when I go and try to find the original owners, they won't talk. They're scared, these people. And so what I did is I noticed that some of those parcels there had some strange histories that involved banks like Zions Bank Corp. And then as I kept clicking, the Reed family name started popping up. And I know from my relationships with some Mormon elders that the Reed family is a very small, tight-knit family, Mormon family, and there aren't that many of them. So if the name Reed pops up in Nevada or Utah, they're related. And so then when I started clicking on the Cedar Development Court, and it looked like that they weren't paying for the land. I mean, there was no assessed value on the land, and it said the county record says that they didn't pay any money for it. And then I started clicking the adjacent USA properties around it, and during the history, the size of those parcels started shrinking, and they always shrunk in related, similar to the similar time periods that changes happened to the status of some of these other lands, like Cedar Development Corp. in the Reed in these Reed Family Trusts and these other LLCs that started buying up these lands. Or started ending up with these lands.
Well, Rusty, let me ask about the Reed Bunkerville LLC, the Reed Family Trust. These groups, these corporations, these trusts, some of them paid nothing for the land. So how does a corporation suddenly just get something for nothing?
Right. That's what I'm saying. What's going on here? I mean, the adjacent BLM parcels started shrinking, and then their parcels started growing, and there's no record of were they buying it or paying for it or what. And I've also noticed in other areas, not exactly in this area, but the BLM buying deeded land for hugely outrageous prices. Small, like there was a parcel down near that, further down the Virgin River there, adjacent to the state wildlife area, they paid over $700,000 for a 10-acre parcel. Now, why? I mean, in that 10-acre parcel, I look closer at it. It has no strategic value whatsoever. So why would they pay $700,000 for a 10-acre parcel in the middle of nowhere? At the most, it's maybe worth $10,000 or $20,000.
The Bureau of Land Management paid $700,000 for a 10-acre parcel of land. Who did they buy it from?
The history is in there. I identified that particular parcel in my video as I was clicking through the area there. And there's that kind of stuff is going on all over Clark County, all over the place. And I would say that there's one of two reasons for that. Somebody politically connected owned that land and cashed in off the taxpayer. Or the BLM is trying to acquire that land for some other reason, and they're willing to pay top dollar for that. Those are the only two reasons. That's the only two reasons that I think that they would pay an outrageously high price for a piece of land that doesn't make any real economic sense. I would say that just based on my experience with what goes on in Nevada, this particular area here, because of the really hard to the access area to the east. I mean, it's almost impossible to get onto this land from the east. And the fact that it's bordered by Lake Mead and the Colorado River to the south and the Overton Arm, and the fact that the BLM has been evicting people out of the area to the west of there for the last 10 years, that the highest value to this land is its remote area that they can do carry on secret activities on. They can secure this area very well.
So what do you anticipate being the military application of the property itself? Because we talked about the magnesium dolomite being used in rocket fuel. So
right.
it can still be mined, though.
Yeah, it could be mined, but there's plenty of that magnesium dolomite all over the place.
What makes this special?
Well, what it is that in the early 90s when I was escorting surveyors out there, that's what they were talking about. And we were noticing a lot of the dolomite stuff, and it's a normal thing all around southern. But what I'm saying now is that because of the way the Nellis Range and the Nevada test site is laid out, this area is way more has way more potential for securing and carrying on secret activities than just about any other land in that area. And part of the problem that these military industrial complex people are having right now is there's a million people living in the Las Vegas Valley, and they want to continue using Nevada as kind of like a secret dumping ground, and they want to carry on secret activities out there that the federal government does, but they're running out of areas to do that with. And when they carry on these activities, they need to have access to a highway. They need to, and I'll tell you right now, the reason why that in real estate 101, the reason why the Bundy Ranch is so important is because just to the east of the Bundy Ranch is a real big sandy arroyo. And it would be real difficult to have access to the east of that arroyo if they want to access this remote land. They need to put in the access through the Bundy Ranch in order to – it'll save them millions of dollars in construction and stuff to put a road right through the Bundy Ranch right up into that area. And also, too, you have to consider – that if they're going to put any kind of development in there, they have to move in utilities. They have to move in electricity. They have to put in water lines. They're probably going to need to pipe in gas lines. And the because of the lay of the land, they need to go right through the middle of the Bundy Ranch to do that. I mean, I've been involved in a lot of developments, and I know by looking at the lay of the land, that's what a sider does. Is a sider knows how to look at the land and know where the roads need to go and know where that kind of where the development needs to be. And the thing is that the sider went in there in the 50s, 60s, or 70s before they built the I-15 and figured this out. And the only reason why there's a major highway interchange where it is there directly north of the Bundy Ranch is because somebody was planning on having access to this highly remote, easily to secure piece of land. Now, things could have changed since then. Back in the 50s and the after World War II, there was a huge bunch of military complex companies going out assessing everything that was going on. Back in the 50s, that really wasn't a good place to develop. But I'm sure that when they were planning I-15, somebody put their word in and said, hey, there's a nice little chunk of remote land right there that somebody might want to have access to at some time. So let's put this $1 million, let's spend a couple of $1 million and put a major interchange in there just in case.
So as a BLM whistleblower, as a whistleblower on these property investigations, since this research can be done by any individual, what is your call to action?
This is my call to action. I back when I was involved in the business, I was trying to whistleblow and inattention back then. I don't have the time to click on every little parcel in Clark County and figure out where the dirt is. But I know that there's plenty of people, patriots out there that have a computer and internet. It can go to the Clark County website and start clicking around these parcels and figure out what's going on and get this information out there. I mean, eventually, at some point, some law enforcement agency has to go in and find out what the heck is going on here. Why are these BLM parcels shrinking? And why are the parcels surrounding these shrinking parcels growing with no exchange of money, at least the way that it's being recorded at the county assessor's office in Las Vegas? I mean, what's going on here? Somebody needs to look into this. Someone needs to find out. Who are these companies? What is the Cedar Development Court? What is the Reed family doing down here buying up these, getting involved in these land deals? I mean, there's been a lot of, I know for a fact that a lot of ranchers have gone out of business in that area and have left and sold their land or I can tell from some of the parcel histories that I've looked at in this area that some of that land was real controversial, and I can tell that some of that land was strategically taken from these people. I know people that's their business. They're called land vultures. They go out and they look for people that are in financial stress, and they put more financial stress. In fact, I knew a guy that what he would do is when he wanted land, he'd go out and tell the owners he's going to call the IRS on them if they don't capitulate. And in a lot of cases, he would call the IRS and make some kind of statement to them.
In this case, the BLM is the agency of choice.
Right. Well, I wouldn't be surprised if next the IRS isn't out there on the Bundys, putting more stress on them. I mean, seriously, what happens in these situations, in a lot of cases, the IRS has got their sniffing around because somebody created some. All you have to do is make a phone call or send them in an email and say that this person is not paying their taxes.
Do you think that what's happening there in Clark County is happening in other counties and other states?
I'd say the whole West is under siege. I mean, I've gone and clicked around in a few areas. I've found a few counties in New Mexico, and some counties this goes on big time in California, big time, in Oregon, in Washington. You go anywhere near an Air Force base or any kind of industrial area where there's BLM land, and you start clicking around, there's suspicious activities going on.
All right.
And the only states that I haven't actually identified this type of activity going on yet is in Wyoming and Idaho. It's a growing situation in Utah. What happened was I heard about 8 years ago from somebody that I know that was a contract worker out at the Nevada test site. He told me that they're shutting the Nevada test site down and they're moving it to Utah because it's so polluted and things are so convoluted out there that they can't carry on business out there anymore. And they want to keep the public thinking that that's all that stuff is going on out there because it'll keep them keep their attention diverted away. And they've moved all of that strange activity into Utah. And so I went in and I started researching what was going on in Utah, trying to find out where that base is. And that's public information too. People can click around. They can go in and check the records in Utah, and they can figure out where it is.
Rusty, what is the website itself?
For Clark County. But all you have to do is Google the Clark County Assessor's Office, and let me physically do it. I got a link right here. Let me pop it up on my computer so that I can check it out. Basically, it depends on how high tech the area is. Some counties aren't as high. Clark County has a lot of money because of the casinos. So everything is all state-of-the-art, high-tech stuff going on. And they have one of the most advanced systems for doing research. The name of the website that I use to get this information is in capital letters, G-I-S-M-O.
Gizmo.
Gizmo. It used to be called the Clark County Info Mapper. And I got it coming up here. Okay. The actual website address is gisgate.co.clark.nv.us. It's in /open web/. This is in a, but what it is according to the law, all land transactions have to be public record nationally. And what the counties across the United States that have the money and can afford it make this information available on the internet. But anybody can go to any county recorder's office anywhere in the United States and get a whole title history of what goes on land. If a bank has a lien on the land, that lien has to be recorded. All of that information is recorded in the county's recorder office anywhere in the United States. Now, anybody can go down. A lot of those actual documents aren't available online in Clark County, but you can go down to the Clark County Assessor's Office and on some of those parcels like the Cedar Development Corp. and Reed Land Trust, and you can see if there's any lien land. You can see if they paid cash for it or not, or there'll be some kind of record, or there'll be some kind of information available supposedly of why there isn't a recorded amount for the land there. Because what happens is when a county assessor is doing a tax assessment, the first thing they look at is how much the people paid for the land. So when you have a piece of land that has a long-term title history with a lot of changing hands and it comes up zero, there's only two ways that can happen. One is because it was an original settler that had rights to that land, and they never sold it, and the name changed because a daughter of the family married somebody and got a different surname. The other reason why it would show up zero is because someone's hiding something. And I've noticed that the only other time that it comes up zero is if the BLM is involved.
All right. Well, Rusty, I think you've really gave us an articulate cross-section, dissection, if you will, of what is happening there in the Clark County region where the Bundy Ranch is. We are up against the clock. Do you have any final thoughts that you want our audience to take away from this?
Yes. The bottom line is people need to start. I mean, we can't wait around for law enforcement or someone to dig up the dirt on what's going on with this stuff. Anybody that has the time needs to go online and start researching what's going on with the land in your area. If you're wherever you live in the United in the Western United States, in New Mexico, Arizona, Nevada, California, Oregon, and Washington especially, you need to if they don't have it online, go down to the county recorder's office and start looking at what's going on with these BLM lands that are adjacent to private ownership, especially if it's owned by a corporation, and start looking at the title history. And with that, eventually law enforcement has got to start taking a look at this. There's a huge amount of crooked activity going on, and we're really fortunate actually that this Bundy Ranch situation happened, because this corruption, this information that I'm giving you, as far as I'm concerned, is just the very tip of a huge rotten iceberg.
All and right. every Rusty, people yeah? We are up against the clock, and clearly the Bundy Ranch fiasco is melting that iceberg as we speak with the information that you have provided us in this interview. Thank you for joining us. We do have to go. That was Rusty Hill, a BLM whistleblower. You heard it right here on the Next News Network. I'm Gary Franchi, signing off.